Data science methods and tools. We're going to welcome the speaker, Szilard Pafka. He's chief scientist at a company called Epic, although those of us who know him are never quite sure exactly what he does. It's sort of clear that if he did tell us, he'd have to kill us. So he's also the king of meetups in LA. So he's involved with R meetup, machine learning meetup, big data meetup, the data visualization meetup, the data science track. So the list is long. So I'm sure he's going to have a very compelling discussion about data science today. So let's welcome Szilard.
Thank you, Daniel, for the great introduction. I also have a quick introduction. So I started 20 years ago in physics, and that's a good place to start if you wanted to get 20 years later in data science. So I was doing statistical modeling of financial prices at the physics department, and I got my PhD in that. Then I was working in a bank doing risk modeling, Before the financial crisis, about a year before that, I would wish to say that by design, but it was absolutely by luck, I moved out of the financial industry and I came here to California to work for an e-commerce company and do data mining, machine learning, and those kind of things that now is called data science. So I would say that probably in the last 15 years, I've been doing what now is called data science. And 5 years ago, I started the R meetup, which was the first data science meetup in LA. We didn't call it data science at that time. And just about a year ago, I started the data visualization meetup. And a few months ago, the data science meetup within the machine learning meetup. So pretty much Subhash and I are organizing or getting involved in most of the data science and big data meetups. And this is great. The data science track, it seems like, is one of the most popular in this camp. So I'm also, as Daniel said, I'm chief scientist at Epic, but I'm not representing Epic here. I can actually neither confirm nor deny that the things I'm going to talk about, they are used at Epic or not. How many of you know or have seen the slide before? All right, so probably like 15% of the audience. So I used to joke that this is the only slide you need for a data science talk. I gave several talks with completely different content. Some of them were like 15 minutes introduction to data science, 30 minutes talk about pitfalls in data science, and there was also like a 3-hour talk, which was more like a training session about methods and tools in data science. So if you have come to one of my previous talks, no worries. This talk has completely new content, and I have now something like 30 more slides. But keep in mind this is some kind of high-level overview of data science, and this is... So the whole talk will transfer from this. So what do we do here? So this will work a little bit. So what we do once we have data, we start exploring the data. We use a lot of visualization. Then we start cleaning the data and make transformations. And then once the data is good for modeling, we are starting to doing the machine learning, the modeling part. And then we should validate our models. And if something good comes out, then we can deploy them in production. Or if it's something like a wisdom, then we can communicate it back to the business. And we see that we'll use their visualization also a lot. So if you have been, how many of you would say that you are data scientist or doing some similar work? All right. So if you are so, you probably see that this is kind of what you've been doing for years. And unlike Hadoop and big data, I think data science is not really new. So we've been doing most of these things for decades. And actually, I would say that the foundation, 80% of data science is decades old. So you can tweet that or this slide. So let's go into a little bit into the parts. So we explore the data. We do the data cleaning, which is, for example, looking for outliers or removing errors. We do transformations, which could be something like scaling variables, normalizing variables, or feature engineering, where we combine various observations and various variables into one super feature. And we do a lot of data munging. And when we are talking about tools we use for data munging, then those tools are both used for this kind of exploratory data analysis, but they are also used to operationalize like a data pipeline, like this one, for example. Well, it's sad, but it's true that we spend 80% of our time playing with the data, doing data munging, and there are several reasons for that. So one is that data munging is very manual. It's hard to automate. It's time consuming. It's also, I think, very important for the quality of anything what you do further in modeling, that you have clean and good data. So we're actually not wasting our time doing this. And there is another reason or aspect of this. So this is a book, actually it's from, it appeared in 1999, so it's not really new. But for those guys who are complaining about this, I would say this. So you really need to play with the data, to prepare the data, because it both prepare the data and the data scientist. So, and back to the original slide. So, this whole process, I forgot to say that it's iterative, so in each stage you might need to go back to another one. I put here a few arrows, but there are many more, so you just didn't want to clean the slide clutter. So, once we do this kind of cleaning, we also go back here to understanding really what's going on in the data. So the next thing is the modeling. This is what's in the media, the sexy part, the fancy math. And I think this is obviously the most challenging part to learn because of the math. So you kind of need to spend a little bit with linear algebra and probability theory. So by the way, this book is, I think, the Bible. So if you are very serious about data science, machine learning in practice, then I recommend, I think this is the best book. And also the first edition is probably like 15 years old. So what do we need to do to be effective when we are applying machine learning in practice? So I think we need several things. One is we need to understand the math, and we also need to understand, more importantly, what happens under the hood in an algorithm. Then we need to understand, based on that, the advantages and disadvantages of various algorithms. Here are a few, based on various factors. And then maybe contrary to this, what I recommend is use a ready-to-go library. So for instance, in R, you can fit a machine learning model with one line of code. So then maybe it comes surprising, but then you would ask, why do I need to do this to understand this if I can just use a ready-to-go library? And I think that there are so many moving parts and there is so many pitfalls in statistics that you really want to have someone who can detect if something goes wrong. and take the proper action. So if we want to select some algorithm, we might have several criteria like scalability, since we are the big data camp. But if we just go for the performance, there are several studies that have looked at a lot of data sets, and they have come up with some kind of performance measures for various machine learning algorithms. This is pretty much what I see on the data sets I've been working for. So the top ones in performance are the ones that are flexible. They use some kind of regularization, and they have been invented in the 90s and 2000s, so something like more newish. So random forest, support vector machine, boosted decision trees, and artificial neural networks. And then it comes further down the line, like logistic regression, which uses like a too strong regularization, perhaps. Then k-nearest neighbors that uses very little regularization. And then you would see down the list a naive Bayes, which uses completely wrong assumptions. But what's striking is that if you look at the mean performance, and this is some kind of scaled accuracy measure, there is no so much difference between them. So one thing that comes from my experience with doing all these data science projects is that two things. So again, the data cleaning and understanding your data, and also building the right features, which also somehow incorporates always the domain knowledge that you get in the business that you are working. So you might get with one of the more sophisticated algorithms, like maybe 5% lift in accuracy versus like medium performing algorithms, but you might also get like 20% lift with just cleaning the data or building a feature that captures really what's going on in that business. Now, if you are a machine learning researcher, how many of you are machine learning researchers? Then obviously you concentrate mostly on the algorithm, and you would develop your own algorithms, you would write the code. But otherwise, I would suggest learn the domain knowledge, spend 80% of your time with cleaning the data and building the features, and then use a ready-to-go library that someone has written and is well-tested. Actually, R and Python, both, they have pretty well-tested ones. Now I want to sell you visualization. So how many of you can tell me which data point? There is one outlier here. And to help you, this is like a time series. And it's if you scan it by row, then you would probably see the outlier. Which one? 0.3. No. Let me help you, because I saw that you would guess it in like 10 seconds. And the point would have been not that you're not able to guess it, but it takes 10 seconds to guess it. So it's the 877 right there. All right. So the point is that it probably takes 10 seconds to, or even more. And how long it takes now, right? So it's now it's pretty obvious. So it's not only easier, it's also much quicker. So I meet many people who are doing data science or machine learning with real data, and they tell me they never use visualization. And I just don't know, if you're a data scientist, how can you live without visualization? So visualization comes in two forms. So let me go back to the main slide. So I've been talking about this visualization. So I think I've shown you that how powerful can be here visualization to detect hot flashes. And visualization comes also here when we communicate our results to someone. And it's equally powerful. And the difference between the two is, I would call this exploratory graphs visualization, where you do the graphs for yourself, you do a lot of them, you iterate, and they don't need to be pretty. And here, you communicate, so you would spend, you would polish them more. You would, or you use like, I don't know, 10 to 100 graphs here, and maybe two here, and then you would spend more time and more thought on how you do this. So I think one of the best examples of the second is, how many of you guys know who this guy is? Yeah, it's been a long time ago. It's been in 2007. This is the famous TED Talk from Hans Rosling, and he's a health researcher, and he was he has a very nice visualization. You can check it out. It's on YouTube. He explains with some dynamic visualization the relationship between, for example, between GDP per capita in different countries and the life expectancy, or those kind of measures. And all these bubbles are like countries, and the colors are continents, and they are also moving since it's on a dynamic visualization. So let me talk about, now that we kind of walk through this whole life cycle of the data science process, let's talk a little bit about tools. So here are the tools I use. You would see that it's mainly R, a lot of Hadley Wickham's packages. I use Nitar for making my analysis reproducible, and RStudio. And why do I use R? So I think that in data science you need higher abstraction tools than, for example, written C++ or Java code. And because you have to iterate, everything is like a try and error. And then you throw away a lot of code. So you don't want to waste writing hundreds of lines of code and then throw it away. So R has a lot of facilities, and you can do a lot of things with one or two lines of code, and then if it doesn't work out, then you just throw that away. So R has the data frame object, and operations are vectorized, and that makes some kind of clean use of code possible. You would also see that the other thing I use is basically SQL, and all this is SQL. I think even if we have a lot of unstructured data, data analysis and modeling, especially machine learning, is always on structured data. So we build this kind of structured data. And then still a lot of the data in corporate businesses is in relational databases. If it's in Hadoop, a lot of times is in Hive, and I'm really excited about the real-time capabilities of Hadoop. I'm using Impala, but there are like five other interactive SQL capabilities in Hadoop, and I'm not using Spark yet, but I'm looking at that. So I think Hadoop was terrible for data science until it was all batch. Because that's against iteration. So you don't want to run like a query for 10 minutes. You want it to run even a few seconds so that you can see the results and then you can ask the next question. So, but now it's really exciting. So Impala and all the other options, they make this really possible. So what tools other people use? And I ran this survey at the last data science / machine learning meetup. There were 200 people, And I had questions about three sections. One was data munging, visualization, and machine learning. And it seems like people are using kind of the same tools as I'm using, except for Python. And I have nothing against Python. I love Python. If R didn't exist, I would use Python. So it seems like about half of the people are using R, half Python. You can see that a lot of people are using SQL. Even the Hadoop usage is mostly Hive. And then a minority Excel. And then if you go to visualization, it's kind of R, Python, and then this minority who doesn't want to write code, they use Tableau. And and then you want to guess what people are using for machine learning? Yeah, they are using R and Python. So I know this survey is biased towards people who come to meetups. They tend to be more like open source folks. So I'm pretty sure that the usage of commercial tools like MATLAB or SAS, it's much more than in this survey, and I agree with that. And there are several other surveys, so you can check them out. I wrote a blog post about this, so you would see it here. And you can Google for other surveys. KD Nugget made just one, and Rexer, CarRexer also has a survey. So the only problems with the other surveys is that I always seen all the surveys like one tool that's kind of extraordinarily outstanding. And in different surveys, this tool is different. So this is completely unbelievable. So I wouldn't even take a guess how that can happen. So I've talked about the process, I've talked about the tools. So the question begs, is data science new? And obviously, there is all this hype that's also driving people here to the big data camp, both the data science hype and the big data hype. And yes, if we look at the data science term, it's not completely new, but it has been used increasingly in the last couple of years. It has been reinvented, to say. And here's the Google trend for the search term data science. We also have seen reputable people saying that data science is a newly emerging field. Then I found out that I have a sexy job. I actually immediately forwarded that to my boss. And there is also McKinsey telling that there is such high demand for data scientists and big data professionals. So let's see this quote, which kind of, I think, summarizes where is the data science today or the state of data analysis. So let me translate a little bit. So the first one says that we use statistics. The second one is that we use a lot of computing. The third one says that we have larger and larger data sets, big data. And the fourth says that we have data in more and more areas. So how many of you would agree with that this four characterizes data science today? All right. I agree. And I have something better. So this quote is from 1965. And I absolutely agree. So this is John Tukey, I would say the first data scientist. This is verbatim from 1965. So we've been doing this for like 50 years. And I think we've done a lot of work in the last 50 years. So I would say that, again, that probably 80-90% of the data science is decades old. What I'm not saying is, I'm not saying at all that there is nothing new. So in the next few slides, I will show you a lot of new stuff. So all I'm saying that it's not completely new. So, five years ago, before the data science hype, I gave a talk at a conference. There were several mini hypes before data science. It was data mining, and it was predictive analytics, right? And this is from 2009, the talk I gave, and these are like little screenshots from my slides. So you can see it's kind of the three topics, the data exploration, visualization, and I had to call it predictive models, but it's basically machine learning. And this conference was attended by mostly by people using commercial tools like SAS or Clementine, which became later SPSS Clementine, then later IBM Modeler. And I've been using R, and at that point it became clear that R is ready to do all the work that I need for the whole process. On the slide, the first slide I've shown you. And I'm trying to convince other people. So here's my conclusion. R is viable tool for data mining, predictive analytics. Substitute that now for data science. So this was about 5 years ago. The data science term was not very much used at that time. And I was even using ggplot. So all I'm saying again that a lot of the stuff is not new, but I'm also saying that a lot of the stuff is new. And I think the pace of innovation in R and in all the other tools and the methods is amazing. So I tried to have here a list of what had the most impact on my workflow in each year. And 2009, ggplot. 2011 R Studio, meet R. And 2010 I attended the first USR conference, and there were a lot of new things I could learn. There is nothing like a big one. And then 2013 I would put the Hadoop Interactive SQL, which really makes Hadoop and big data very interesting for data scientists. By the way, you will see that in all this data science track, we have most of the talks are on like small or medium-sized data. Maybe if you are doing small data stuff, you can call yourself statistician. If you are doing medium size, then you call yourself data scientist. So, what are we dreaming about? What is next? So, I think we need tools like this. And I have seen a video a couple of years ago about what kind of tools we would wish to have for exploratory data analysis. And unfortunately, I don't remember where I've seen it. And I tried to look it up, and I couldn't. So if any of you has slightly idea, then let me know. So this guy was talking, I think it was a video from a conference. So he was arguing that we need tools for exploratory data analysis in which you can do something similar like this guy was doing in the minority report, right? Changing the data and then seeing various aspects. So we are not yet there, but I think we are very close. So ggplot is, I've been using it for 5 years, and for those of you guys who are expert data scientists, I would want to talk a little bit about dplyr. So how many of you are using dplyr right now? Okay. How many of you are data scientists and they are not using dplyr? No? No one dares? All right. So dplyr is kind of the grammar of data manipulation. It's a package by Hadley Wickham, and it's doing similar awesome things as ggplot is doing for visualization. So it's basically a well thought API about what kind of data manipulation functions you need to do 80% of your work. And if you read through this basically filter, mutate, and all this are very similar to SQL. So at least in functionality and what you are doing with that. So actually SQL is not that dumb at all. And I will show you a quick demo. And the other thing is that little operator, which makes possible chaining of various operations one after the other, so that your code looks nice and clean and there are no nested function calls. And this works on top of several data backends, like in-memory data frame or data table, but also it works on databases. And it might come to Hadoop, actually. And this other guy, Romain Francois, is making it blazingly fast. He's writing the code in C++. So let's do, I'm not sure how I'm doing in time. Okay. Then I have to speed up a bit. So Hadley created this baby names table, this baby names package. I'm just gonna use this. So this this data set has the data from the Social Security Administration. It has number of births and names per year, male, female, and the prop is the proportion of the names that were given. And this data set has about almost 2 million rows. So the way dplyr works is that you have the data, then you apply this chaining operator, and then here is your function. So this is, you're now subsetting this year and this sex, and then arrange is the sorting, and if you're running this, then you would see some of the names, and unfortunately I have to speed up. So you would see then in the 50s there were completely different names that were popular. In the 1900s, again, various other names. Select will select the variables. With mutate, you can compute something, like here a new variable, percentage, which is prop times 100. You can do something more complicated, like cumulative sum, ranking, right? And it really becomes nice when you have group by and summarizing. So here you can have totals by year. And then let's get here. So what I want here to do is I want for each year in sex to see the top 20 names and see how much they are together in percentages. And what I do here is this will filter the top 20 names, and then I'm just summing it up. And the nice thing is that you can pipe this into ggplot. And then you can create some graphics which will show you the how the total percentage of the top 20 names evolved during the past 100 years. So you would see that it goes down, so we have more and people are giving more and more diverse names to their kids. So I have to cut it short. And then there is also a Twitter version of this. So I managed to cut it down to like 139 characters. So this one, which comprises both the dplyr and the ggplot. So it's all one tweet. And I want to go back a little bit to the slides, just very quickly. So we have this great data science community in LA, several meetups. These were the old ones, and these are the new ones. And if you're interested, come to those. We also have the USAC conference in LA very soon. you can see the, for example, a 3-hour tutorial about deep fire with Adley Wickham and many other great talks. We are also launching Data Science LA, which will be a blog in which we will try to get all the content from at least from the meetups I'm running and the data science ones, and also provide editorial for any of you who want to contribute to the blog. And finally, this is my contacts. So also grab me in the break. It's always nice to talk in person. If you want to be involved in the meetup, especially if you want to give talks, then let me know. Thank you very much.
Thanks a lot.